when he calls me, I will answer when he calls to answer when he calls me, I will answer. I will be somewhere, I will be somewhere listening for my name.
Morning, Jesus got up with all power in his hand. We thank God for this opportunity to serve our Lord and our risen Savior. Amen. Welcome in our call to worship this morning. Good morning and welcome to worship with Journey United Methodist Church. We are a church committed to investing in missions and service, connecting to the community, and engaging in our discipleship. We are so glad that you are joining us for worship today. God calls us together, even if you are joining virtually, to praise our God together. Early that morning, brave, beautiful, devoted, and faith-filled women made their way to the tomb, to the place they laid Jesus. To their surprise, there was no dead body there. There were no remains at all in the grave. Where is Jesus, they asked, only to meet the one they came to embalm. Jesus has risen. He is not dead. Sin has been conquered, and the women were sent to tell the story. The women were sent to proclaim that humanity had been redeemed. The women were sent to proclaim without fear, he lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Come on, sisters, let us worship the the risen Savior together. Now we're going to welcome our praise and worship.
We come, Almighty God, at this moment. Oh God. Standing in need to approach your throne of mercy, oh God. We come to glorify you. We come to honor you. We come to give you thanks, God, for being our God. Thank you, God, for bringing us through last week. Thank you, God, for hearing our cries. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. Thank you, God, for this little ship of Zion called Journey. Thank you for our esteemed pastor and his leadership, and thank you for the offices and the members, and we thank you for our music ministry. Thank you for each household represented here. God, we give you thanks this morning for all that you've done for us in the past and for all that you're doing right now. Thank you for calling us into this time of worship, Lord. God, there are many here who have specific requests for you this morning, God. There's some who are calling on you, God, to help them deal with that difficult situation. Oh, the job. Lord, some are calling on you this morning, God, because they're having difficulty coping and dealing with situations beyond their control, and they need your mercy and grace this morning. God, there's some who are feeling all alone, and they need God to be comforted by you this morning, and we ask, oh God, in your mercy to comfort them. And those that we find lying in the hospital bed this morning. And Lord, we also lift up one of our members, Mr. McCray. We pray for your healing mercies, and we give you thanks, God, for your healing mercies. God, there's some in their relationships with family, with friends, and perhaps even neighbors, Lord, there is confusion and they don't know how to deal with it. Give guidance where guidance is needed, oh God. And God, there are some here this morning who might be dealing with despair and depression, and they feel that they're in their deepest valleys. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy, God, and dispatch your angels to protect and comfort them, oh God, and lift them up out of the places of despair this morning, God. Merciful God, we are your children who stand in. And God, you know everybody's situation. And whatever that situation is this morning, right now, God, just have mercy. Have mercy, oh Lord, as we stand before you and call on your name. Thank you, God. Thank you for hearing us. Because in your word it says where two or three are gathered in your name, you're in our midst. So thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you. In the name of Jesus the Christ, let the people of God say amen and amen and amen.
Scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 10, English Standard Version. That is Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10, the English Standard Version. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen." And he said, "Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. And there they will see me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Beloved, it's preaching time, and it is my honor and my privilege to introduce the preacher of this morning. The Reverend Dr. Tawana A. Harris is the senior pastor of the Carter Metropolitan Christian Methodist Episcopal Church in Detroit, Michigan. She is the daughter of the Reverend Rosa and the late Napoleon Harris. Born and raised in Indianapolis, Indiana, she is the product of Washington Township Schools. She received a Bachelor of Music Education with emphasis in vocal performance from Lincoln University in Jefferson City, Missouri, as well as a Master of Divinity degree from the Christian Theological Seminary. She completed a Doctor of Ministry degree in the field of practical theology with an emphasis on preaching in May of 2010. Tawana also contributed to the seminary community as director of the CTS Gospel Choir and as a professor of preaching. She has served as a co-director, minister of music since the young age of 10. As a music educator, she was blessed to teach both elementary and high school levels. From 2004 until 2014, Dr. Harris served as the artist in residence for the Black Voices of Inspiration on the campus of Purdue University in West Lafayette, Indiana. A dynamic composer, Tawana has a growing catalog of music in Christian dramatic plays and musical productions. In March of 2021, she officially launched Tawana A. Harris Ministries, a creative arts and media group who create faith-based artistic productions as well as musical and creative writing workshops. As a musician, clinician, and leader in both the secular and spiritual context, Dr. Harris seeks to challenge audiences and workshop participants to explore the depths and heights of their instruments and inspiration. Along with her passion for teaching, Dr. Harris is committed to worship and preaching. Her experience in ministerial leadership is rooted in the United Methodist Church, but spans several denominations. In each ministry context, she has worked with youth and young adults, women, dance ministries, music departments, and has effectively preached the Word of God. Dr. Harris is an ordained elder in Full Connection in the 3rd Episcopal District of the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. She is honored to serve as the chair of the Committee on Ministerial Examination Committee for the Michigan-Indiana region and is the immediate past president of the Detroit Ministerial Alliance. Proudly, Dr. Harris has pastored the Stewart Memorial CME Church in Indianapolis, Indiana, and presently serves as the senior pastor of the Carter Metropolitan CME Church in Detroit, Michigan. Her unique, lively, and spirit-filled interpretation of the gospel has made her a sought-after worship leader, workshop facilitator, and preacher. She desires to help the gospel make sense to hearers of every age, background, gender, and ethnicity. Beloved, after our music ministry blesses us one more time, the next voice we will hear is that of my big sister, my friend, the preacher of the hour, the Reverend Dr. Tawana Harris. Receive the woman of God. Thank you.
bless the Lord at all times, and God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's holy and precious name together. Listen, first giving honor to God who is my life. I praise God for the opportunity to share with the Journey United Methodist Church on this great resurrection morning. I thank God for your pastor, who is my friend and brother, the Reverend Michael Parker II. Listen, you all are blessed to have him as your leader, and I cherish him as my brother. I bring you greetings from the Carter Metropolitan Christian Methodist Episcopal Church here in Detroit, Michigan. We are a church who is attempting to carry out the radical and transformational ministry that God has called us to. We are learning as we grow together that ministry is not just the responsibility of clergy alone, but God in this season is urging fruitful and productive ministry to be birthed all across the church. It's that spirit, it's that vibe that pulls us in the direction of the preaching text for the morning. The text today can be found in Mark chapter 16. I'll be beginning at the first verse, and I'm reading from the New International Version of Scripture. This is what God's word says to us today. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be afraid," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him, but go. Tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." The word of God for the people of God, and we say together, thanks be to God. Y'all, ministry is hard. There are people who make it look easy, but the reality is ministry is the most difficult vocation anyone could ever be asked to consider. The call of ministry sends you to places you never knew existed. It pushes you past limits you never knew you had. It forces you to do things that others refuse to do, all because you make a commitment to God to follow wherever God leads. Ministry starts with a commitment. It's a commitment to trusting that God will send you to places that will fulfill his purposes, believing that he will somehow give you what you need to accomplish the task. Today, we celebrate the fruit of effective ministry, resurrection. The goal of ministry in any context is to bring dead things back to life. We remember that Jesus was so committed to God's plan that persecution couldn't stop him. Death couldn't hold him. The grave couldn't contain him. We get excited because he defeated every enemy. He defeated every sickness. He overcame every adversity once and for all. And it's all because effective ministry manifests miracles. Somebody ought to type that in the chat this morning. Effective ministry manifests miracles. We're healed today because Jesus stayed committed. Come on, somebody. We're delivered from bondage today because Jesus stayed committed. And because he was committed to his ministry, we should be motivated to answer the call to ministry. because effective ministry manifests miracles. People used to be excited when somebody got called into ministry. Folks used to want to be used by God. There was a time when folks didn't mind spending all day in worship, but all of our Sunday school lessons and all of our Bible studies have reminded us that Jesus was committed to ministry, but he still had to suffer. He was committed to ministry, but they still plotted to kill him. He was committed to ministry, but folks on his ministry team sold him out. The commitment that Jesus had to ministry was not swayed by how he felt. In the garden, he felt alone. In the garden, he felt fear. In the garden, he felt pressure, but he kept his commitment to God. I've been challenged, especially in this season, this Lenten season, to keep my commitment, to honor my sacrifice, to remember that the responsibility of ministry is not connected to how I feel about ministry. And I found myself asking the question, what kind of miracles can my ministry produce? Who's going to get a second chance at life because of my commitment to ministry? Not just my preaching, not just my teaching, but am I committed enough to prayer? Am I committed enough to the faith that my service, my worship, and my life brings God the kind of glory that causes him to infiltrate my words and actions and manifest miracles? The question I've been plagued with in this Lenten season is, can my ministry bring anything back to life? So as the story is told, a grief-stricken mother, a daughter, and a friend make their way to the tomb early Sunday morning. They were going to the tomb because in the rush and the trauma of the events that took place on Friday, they were unable to perform their last ministry for their loved one. After watching his trial, after hearing the verdict, after seeing the torture, after watching him die, after watching them, can you see it, take his mangled body down from the cross. They watched as Joseph interred his body in the tomb. They watched as the tomb was sealed with a rock. And then the women went home. They went home to mourn. They went home to cry. They went home perhaps thinking everything happened like he said it would. Early Sunday morning, they had prepared themselves to go back to the tomb. They were going to do the difficult work of ministry. It was a ministry that not too many people wanted to be called into. It was a ministry that some people would not have called a ministry at all. They were going to the burial place of Jesus. They were going to have to close his eyes. They were going to place loving kisses on him. They were going to wash his body and anoint him with perfumes. They were going to the tomb to wrap him in a shroud and cover his face with a special cloth called the sudarium. They were going to tie his hands and feet with strips of cloth because even Jesus had a legal right to ceremonial care. He deserved the best. He deserved to be the recipient of that final ministry. Can I tell you that sometimes ministry has to occur in places where people are unable to acknowledge you, where they can't give you direct feedback, but because you know you have a responsibility to ministry, you simply show up anyway. As I consider these sisters and their task on that resurrection morning, I can't imagine what was going on in their mind and heart. After 3 days, there would be some challenges, come on somebody, to their ministry. After 3 hot days in a tomb with the suffering that his body had endured, he would not look the same. But after 3 days, they still had a job to do. It seems to me like they were determined to stay with Jesus to the very end, even if it hurt, even if it was going to be messy. There were three precautions that were taken to make sure that no one would steal Jesus' body. The Roman government wanted to make sure that the disciples didn't plan to hide his body and go around telling people that he had actually come back to life like he said he would. So there was a stone that was placed in front of the tomb. There was a Roman seal placed over the tomb, which was a sign that the tomb was occupied. And if anyone broke the seal, they would be punished by death. And finally, there was a guard who was placed at the mouth of the tomb. There were so many barriers to get to Jesus. Sometimes when we make a commitment to Jesus, there are stones in our way that block us from getting to Jesus. Sometimes, y'all, those stones look like a person. Sometimes the stones are heavy like depression. Sometimes the stone is jagged like family issues. Sometimes the stone keeps you from getting to Jesus. But sometimes the stone blocks you from getting out of your own tomb. Anybody ever been stuck in a dead place, frozen into position because of a decision or a mindset or even your own will? The sisters were on their way to the tomb and it dawned on them that they've got a job to do, but who was going to move the stone out of the way so that they could do their job? They didn't get frustrated and turn around and go home. They didn't decide that the stone would be too heavy to move and they couldn't possibly make good on their commitment. No, they kept walking in the direction of the tomb. Can you see them? They kept their ministry on their mind. They kept their commitment ever before them. Listen, I can't tell you how many times as a music minister, I wanted to turn around and go back home because I knew nobody was going to show up to choir rehearsal. I can't tell you how many times in ministry, but how many ministry ideas I talked myself out of because I didn't think that there would be anybody to help me make it happen. But the sisters in the text decided to keep moving forward, even though they anticipated an obstacle in their way. When they got to the tomb, your Bible says that the stone had already been rolled away. The thing they were worried about, the obstacle they were preparing to face, had already been moved out of the way. I just want to encourage a missionary today that while you're on your way to visit a member, I want to encourage a prayer warrior that while you're trying to find enough free time to pray, if you're in the house today and you want to come to buy Bible study, or if you want to join a ministry, but something always jumps in your way, can I tell you that if you just keep moving in the direction of your assignment, if you just keep going in spite of the potential obstacles, if you go on in spite of who may or may not show up, if you go not having all of the answers before you get there, the God who keeps his promises, the God who jumps over obstacles, the God who separates up from down and night from day and earth from sky will open the door. That same God will remove the stone so that you can finish what he started in you. The commitment of those sisters took them to the tomb. And they found out that the miracle had already occurred. Jesus was alive. Jesus kept his promise. Jesus did the impossible. These sisters were committed to their ministry, and in the process, they walked right into a miracle. Their commitment to ministry positioned them to be the first to hear that Jesus was alive. Their commitment prepared them to be the first to go and share the heart of the gospel. But their commitment gave them boldness to go and find the men who were in hiding and tell them that he got up so you can get up. He got up so you can live. He got up so you can start over. He got up so you can have a clean slate. He got up so that you can get well. The ministry that took these women to the tomb ended up taking them out into all of the world. That day, evangelism was taken to another level because they got up early to do a hard thing. That day, evangelism was taken to another level because they got up early to do a hard thing. This is Resurrection Sunday. And we have a lot to be glad about. I'm not just glad, y'all, that he got up. I'm not just happy that he saved my life and my eternal soul, but I feel encouraged today that if I just do the hard thing, come on, if I keep going, even if there's going to be some stones in my way, that there will be some good news waiting on me. There will be a miracle waiting on me. If I'm faithful to what he's called me to do, he will turn a burial into birth. He'll turn an end into a beginning. He'll open the doors that others intended to remain closed. Jesus was going to get out of the grave, whether the sisters showed up or not. The stone was going to get pushed back, whether the sisters showed up or not. And the grave clothes were going to be set aside because that was God's plan all along. But because the sisters were committed to their ministry, they got to be a witness. They got to be a testimony. They got a new assignment. They were called to a brand new ministry. Good morning, Journey. God told me to meet you by the tomb early this resurrection morning and remind you that you have been called to a ministry. There is something very specific, something very necessary that God needs you to do for him. And some days, y'all, it may not be easy. And some days it may be a hard thing to do. But if you don't do the hard thing, if you don't show up at the tomb, ready to be committed to the very end, you'll never get to the good news. You'll never see dead things live again. Let me just shout real quick early on this resurrection morning. I'm shouting with you, Journey, because your church can live again. Your marriage can live again. Your hopes can live again. Your dreams can live again. Your ministry, your individual ministry can live again. The sisters in the text showed up to the tomb expecting to do one thing. But when they got there, they got more than they could ever have expected. Listen, I pray when you show up to church that you get more than you ever expected. I pray that when you show up to prayer that you get more than you could ever expect. I pray that when you show up to worship, when you show up to Bible study, I pray that when you show up to do the work that nobody acknowledges, that you walk away with more than you ever expected. That's how you see the miracle. So may the power of the resurrection show up in your ministry. May the miracle of expectation show up in your faith. And may you find Jesus everywhere you search for him. God bless you.
Beloved, what an amazing, what a powerful, what a transformative word Dr. Harris has just shared with us this day. And I know your heart is filled to overflowing. I know you are ready to respond to the word. I know you're ready to put your life right in God's hand. So my sister, if you're watching us today and you don't have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, I invite you. Accept the Lord today. Here's how you can do it. Right in that comment box, just write the word connect. Just one easy word, connect. And someone from our ministerial team will reach out to you. We'll love to take the journey of faith with you. But let me pray with you right now. If that's you and you're ready to make a commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ, if you need a church home to connect with, we would love to be your church family. We would be excited about walking along with you. Come on, let's pray. Pray with me. God, I need you. And I believe that you died for me. I believe that you were buried for me. And I believe that early this morning, you got up just for me. So come into my life for the rest of my life. Save me and make me brand new. I thank you for the gift that salvation is. And I believe this day that I am now saved. My life is no longer the same. Thank you for changing me. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. If that's your first time praying a prayer of salvation, can I be the first one to say welcome to the family? Listen, we want to know about the decision that you just made. So make sure you put the word connect in that comment box. We want to celebrate with you. And we want to celebrate you for making Jesus Lord of your life.
Thank you for joining us today for worship. It is our prayer that you have been blessed by the worship and strengthened by the preached word. We invite you to stay connected with us by visiting our website, www.journeyeverywhere.org, and by connecting with us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. All of our upcoming ministry activities and worship services can be found there. Your faithful stewardship and extravagant generosity enabled us to invest, connect, and engage. Thank you for your continued giving. To give today, please visit our website. Again, that web address is www.journeyeverywhere.org. You can also give using Givelify. Be sure to search for us under the name of our mother church, United Methodist Church of the Redeemer. Or you can mail your offering to the church office. That information is provided for you on the screen. We look forward to taking the journey of faith with you. Stay connected. There's always something going on here at Journey United Methodist Church.
We heard the preached word. Perhaps we've heard the retelling of the story that has been told over and over and over again about a Savior who came. And that Savior who died on that cross at Calvary for all of us. And perhaps there was something that was said this morning that strengthened our faith, deepened our hope and our belief in the power and might of Jesus Christ. And so as we prepare to depart from this place, from this worship experience, our prayer is that to our awesome God, that God give us the faith
to remain faithful, that God give us the faith to endure, the faith to hold on during difficult times, and the faith to continue to run this race. This is our prayer. In the name of Jesus the Christ, let the people of God say amen and amen and amen.